My name is Olivier Demblum. I'm 44 years old and I'm the gallery director of Opera Gallery here in Hong Kong. I've been visiting Hong Kong for 15 years, where I relocated 3 years ago. I've been working in finance for more than 15 years and I'm an art collector myself. I come from a family. My mom is a painter, my dad is a sculptor as hobbies. But I'm a collector. I never had, sadly, the chance to build anything by myself. But I think collecting is a way to appropriate yourself the emotions that actually are crystallized by others through the form of artwork. Art has always been, to me, a destination. This is where I was spending most of my time and also allocating my money to. And once I met Gilles, who is the owner of Opera, and Gilles offered me, while we were discussing the previous premises of Opera Gallery, he offered me to actually join the gallery and turn my destination into the journey, the everyday journey. So, of course, it's a bit complicated because it's not because you're buying a car, you want to sell a car by yourself, but art is very different. I think it's a lot of simulation, the people, the products, the environment. And I was, of course, thrilled and very happy to accept his proposal and join to actually turn out my everyday. Opera Gallery is a group of 13 galleries in the world. This is a group that has been created by Gilles Dien in 1994 in Singapore. So we've been advising in art for 30 years. I think we position ourselves as advisors, which is very important because this means we are here to accompany art lovers into their journey of collecting art. So we aim at being present at every stage of the collection journey. We are here to help people to understand themselves because art is very personal. So we are here we're aiming at helping them to understand themselves, get to know what they like, navigate actually the entire spectrum of the art offering, the global one, not just local, both contemporary as well as secondary market. And we are here actually to create a long sustainable relationship with them. We are specialists from mid-20th century to today. So we do post-war and contemporary. So in the basement here these days, you have in the storages some Picassos, some Buffet, even a Dubuffet. This is actually what we are experts at. So our strength is our network of collectors. When I joined Opera, Gilles and I were sharing a vision that art actually should be accessible to everyone. Also knowing the Hong Kongese market and knowing the Hong Kongese art scene, we're thinking that opening our gallery to a broader audience and making art accessible to everyone would be a plus, not for us as a gallery, but for the Hong Kongese art lovers. So we decided to move from Wingdom to here and take over this store, which is 5,500 square feet, to make it actually a better venue that is like museum slash foundation style, keeping in mind that we are a gallery and our first purpose is, of course, to sell the artwork. So we try to stimulate the art scene with this gallery by showing outstanding artists, by showing masters. We started the gallery here with the first show with Chu Tichun, who is a French-Chinese master. So very, very different from the show that we are displaying these days with Basquiat, Harring and Scharf, that is more pop, more street. But still, I think the purpose is always the same. It's actually to provoke, I mean, to challenge perceptions, to provoke vital debates and discussions and to challenge actually people and help them to think critically around the world. The current show, which is the second show of Opera Gallery 9 Queens Road, is on Basquiat, Harring and Scharf, which are the three musketeers of New York. So these are people, three guys who were born late 50s, who moved to New York, so born in the US, moved to New York and turned friends under the sponsorship and with the friendship of Andy Warhol, so big names. They all have in common the fact they use street art as a forum of expression because like us at Opera, they were thinking that art should be accessible to everyone, to a broad audience. So street is the best forum to maximize the audience and circulate the messages you have. And also they were all free minds, well determined not to follow any commercial or institutional rules. We contacted a lot of collectors to actually source some paintings that we thought could make sense. Of course, it's very complicated because we are bringing back to the market pieces that collectors are not willing to sell. We are bringing back to the market pieces that collectors have been curating themselves with care, with passion. And as a collector, I can say, when you have something, you don't want to sell it. You want to keep it. It's an obsession. And this is collection. This is emotion. So the idea was to convince them they should give us the pieces. And to be frank and honest, on some artists like Basquiat, until the very last hour before we released the press release, we had no clue if we would get the Basquiat. So we finally got the four. But when the Basquiat's, when the press release went out, we didn't even know how much we would price them. So this is kind of like the struggle of a gallery life. On Scharf, for instance, or Harring or Basquiat, the complexity is to bring like big pieces or unprecedented scenes pieces. On Harring, we have a 4.7 times 2.4 meters gigantic painting that we actually managed to obtain. This was also present in a show we were running on Keith Harring in Miami before. So that's a piece we managed to bring back here. I think it's a very emblematic piece. Harring was born in a Catholic family that actually Catholicism condemns homosexuality, and he's been always struggling and fighting against any form of totalitarianism. So this painting actually highlights a supreme authority, and this is that kind of criticism of supreme power. We could also see a second reading, which is about like modernity and aliens actually on the painting. That's the first thing. The second piece we could disclose here is Basquiat. So Basquiat, when back in the early 80s, was offered to work for a gallery in New York, and he was given a basement. And the very first art piece he produced is this print that we have downstairs, which is 18 plates, actually, that represent anatomical parts of the human body. So Basquiat, when he was seven, was hurt by a car. He had a car accident and he spent many months at the hospital. His mom offered to him the Grey's Anatomy book, right? Not the Netflix series, but the scientific book of dissection of human body. And he memorized everything. He's a genius, he memorized everything. So the 18 plays are inspired after this Grey's Anatomy book. From my observations, the Hong Kongese market is very trend-driven and contemporary-focused. So I think the main challenge for Hong Kong is to mature and embrace a more holistic and global approach of art. No matter you like contemporary or impressionism or whatever, I think you need a global understanding of the market. People should try to emancipate themselves a bit by knowing more about the global market, and not just geographically speaking, but also in terms of timeline, maybe looking back to what was before to have a better understanding of what is today and if this really makes sense to them. I think art is about getting to know yourself first before you start collecting. I think Hong Kong is turning a very important actor on the art stage. I mean, we are patrons of the M+ Museum. It's one of the four biggest museums in the world. I think this is driving some crazy energy. I think like Hong Kong is kind of an Asian New York. If we look at the New Yorkese art scene and we look where we stand today in Hong Kong, it's a highway. It's a highway for improvement. In terms of talent attraction, I think we can definitely attract some more talents to develop and create here in Hong Kong.